And so it did not catch the word aright through being hard of hearing, mistaking my instructions, which within my brain did gyrate. I took and bound the promising boy, apprentice to a pirate.
Oh!
A sad mistake it was to make and doom him to a vile lot. I bound him to a pirate. You, instead of to a pilot. I soon found out beyond all doubt the scope of this disaster, but I hadn't the face to return to my place and break it to my master. A nursery maid is not afraid of what you people call work. So I made up my mind to go as a kind of piratical maid of all work. And that is how you find me now, a member of your Shylock, which you wouldn't have found had he been bound. Apprentice to a pilot. Oh, pardon, Frederick, pardon.
Right, sweet one, I have long pardoned you.
The two words were so much alike.
They were. They still are. Though years have rolled over their heads. But this afternoon, my obligation ceases. Individually, I love you all with affection unspeakable.
Aww.
But collectively, I look upon you with a disgust that amounts to absolute detestation.
Oh,
pity me, my beloved friends. For such is my sense of duty that, once out of my indentures, I shall feel myself bound to devote myself heart and soul to your extermination.
Poor lad! Poor lad!
Well, Frederick, if you conscientiously feel that it is your duty to destroy us, we cannot blame you for acting on that conviction. Always act in accordance with the dictates of your conscience, my boy, and chance the consequences.
Besides, we can offer you but little temptation to remain with us. We don't seem to make piracy pay. I'm sure I don't know why, but we don't.
I know why. But alas, I mustn't tell you. It wouldn't be right.
Why not, my boy? It's only... half past 11. And you are one of us until the clock strikes 12.
True, and until then you are bound to protect our interest.
Here!
Well, then it is my duty as a pirate to tell you that you are too tender-hearted. For instance, you make a point of never attacking a weaker party than yourself, and when you attack a stronger party, you invariably get thrashed.
There is some truth in that.
Then again, you make a point of never attacking an orphan.
Of course! We are orphans ourselves and know what it is.
Yes, but it's got about. And what is the consequence? Everyone we capture says he's an orphan. Why, the last three ships we took proved you manned entirely by orphans. So we had to let them go. One would think Great Britain's mercantile navy was recruited solely from her orphan asylums, which we know is not the case.
But hang it all, you wouldn't have us absolutely merciless.
Here's my difficulty. Until 12 o'clock, I would. After 12, I wouldn't. Was ever a man placed in so delicate a situation?
And Ruth, your own Ruth, whom you love so well and who has won her middle-aged way into your boyish heart. What a
He will take you with him.
Well, Ruth, I feel some little difficulty about you. It is true I admire you very much, but I have been constantly at sea since I was 8 years old, and yours is the only woman's face I've seen during that time. I think it is a sweet face.
It is.
It is!
I say, I think it is. That is my impression. But as I have never had the opportunity of comparing you with other women, it's just possible I may be mistaken.
True.
What a terrible thing would be for me to marry this innocent person and then find that she is, on the whole, plain.
So, Ruth is very, very well, indeed.
Yes, there are the remains of a fine woman about Ruth.
Do you really think so?
I do.
Well, then I will not be so selfish as to take her from you. In justice to her, and in consideration for you, I will leave her behind.
Oh, Frederick! This must not be. We are rough men.
Rough!
Who lead a rough life.
Rough, rough!
But we are not so utterly heartless as to deprive thee of thy love. I think I am right in saying that there is not one here who would rob thee of this inestimable treasure, for all the world holds dear.
Not one!
No, I thought there wasn't. Keep thy love, Frederick. Keep thy love.
You are very good, I'm sure.
Well, it's the top of the tide, and we must be off. Farewell, Frederick. When your process of extermination begins, let our deaths be as swift and painless as you can conveniently make them.
I will. By the love I have for you, I swear it. Would that you could render this extermination unnecessary by accompanying me back to civilization.
No, no. It cannot be. I don't think much of our profession. But contrasted with respectability, it is comparatively honest. No, Frederick. I shall live and die. A pirate king! Oh, better far to live and die under the brave black flag I fly than play a sanctimonious part with a pirate head and a pirate heart. Away to the cheating world go you, where pirates all are well-to-do. But I'll be true to the song I sing, and live and die a pirate king. For I am a pirate king. And it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king, for I am a pirate king.
Honor of the pirate king.
And it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king.
It is honor of the pirate king, honor of the pirate king. Ha! Ha! Ha!
I sally forth to seek my prey. I help myself in a royal way. I sink a few more ships, it's true, than a well-bred monarch ought to do. But many a king on a first-class throne, if he wants to call his crown his own, must manage somehow to get through more dirty work than e'er I do. For I am a pirate king, and it is a glorious thing to be a pirate king, for I am a pirate king.
acquainted with you. You are very dear to me, as you know, but I must be circumspect. You see, you are considerably older than I. Why, a lad of 21 usually looks for a wife of 17.
Wife of 17? You will find me a wife of 1,000!
No, but I will find your wife of 47, and that is quite enough.
Oh.
Ruth, tell me candidly, without reserve, compared with other women, how are you?
Well, I will answer you truthfully, Master. I have a slight cold. But otherwise, I am quite well.
I'm sorry for your cold, but I was referring rather to your personal appearance. Compared with other women, are you beautiful?
Oh, I have been told so, dear Master.
But lately? What do you think of yourself?
It is a delicate question to answer, but I think I am a fine woman.
That is your candid opinion?
Oh, yes. I should be deceiving you if I told you otherwise.
Thank you, Ruth. I believe you, for I'm sure you were not practiced on my inexperience. I wish to do the right thing, and if, I say if, you really are a fine woman, your age shall be no obstacle to our union. Hear voices. Who has ventured to approach our all but inaccessible lair? Can it be Coast Guard? No, doesn't sound like Coast Guard.
Confusion! It is the voices of young girls. If he should see them, I am lost.
By all that's marvelous, a bevy of beautiful maidens.
Lost! Lost! Lost!
How lovely, how surpassingly lovely is the plainest of them. What grace! What delicacy! What refinement! And Ruth! Oh. Ruth told me she was beautiful!
Oh, false one! You have deceived me!
I have deceived you!
Yes, deceived me! You told me you are fair as gold.
And master, am I not so?
And now I see you're plain and old.
I'm sure I'm not a jot so.
Upon my innocence you play.
I'm not the one to plot so.
Your face is lined, your hair is gray.
It's gradually got so.
Faith, this woman to deceive me, I trusted so.
Master, master, do not leave me. Hear me ere you go.
Faithless woman.
Master, master.
Faithless woman.
Master, master.
Faithless woman, to deceive me, I would trusted so. Faithless woman, to deceive me, I would trusted so.
faithless woman to deceive me, I would trust it so. Faithless woman to deceive me, I would trust it so. What shall I do before these gentle maidens? I dare not show in this alarming costume. No, no, I must remain in close concealment until I can appear in decent clothing.
Die. Breathe them gaily as they where Papa is. We have left him ever so far behind.
Oh, he will be here presently. Remember, poor Papa is not as young as we are, and we came over a rather difficult country.
But how thoroughly delightful it is to be so entirely alone. Why, in all probability, we're the first human beings who ever set foot on this enchanting spot.
Except for mermaids. It's the very place
for mermaids
who are only human beings down to the waist.
And who can't be said strictly to set foot anywhere. Tails they may, but feet they cannot.
Luncheon?
Well, we are quite alone, and the sea is as smooth as glass. Suppose we take off our shoes and stockings and paddle.
Oh, yes, yes, the very thing!
Stop, ladies, pray. I had intended not to intrude myself upon your notice in this effective but alarming costume. But under these peculiar circumstances, it is my bounden duty to inform you that your proceedings will not be unwitnessed.
Well, who are you, so speak?
I am a pirate!
A pirate! Horror!
This evening I renounce my vile profession, and to that end, O pure and peerless maidens, O blushing birds of ever-blooming beauty, I swore at heart, implore your kind assistance. Above you, if you will If you will cast your eyes on me, however plain you be, I love you, I love you, I love, I love.
masters say, propriety we know, says we ought to stay, while sympathy exclaims, free them from your tether, play at other games. Leave them here together. Her case may any day be yours, my dear, or mine. Let her make her hay while the sun doth shine. Let us compromise. Our hearts are not of leather. Let us shut our eyes and talk about the weather.
Yes, yes, let's talk about the weather. Beautifully blue the sky, the grass is rising very high. Continue fine, I hope it may, and yet it's great like yesterday. Tomorrow with me for again, I hear the country wants a rain. If people say I know not when, that we shall have a warm July. Tomorrow with me for again, I hear the country wants a rain. If people say I know not when, that we shall have a warm July. Tomorrow with me for again, I hear the country wants a rain.
Our senses, men who seek at no offenses will anon be here. Piracy, the dreadful trade is. Pray you get your hint, young ladies, while the coast is clear.
No, we must not lose our senses. If we seek at no offenses, we should not be here. Piracy, the dreadful trade is. Nice companions for young ladies. Let us disappear.
It's a first-rate opportunity to get married with impunity and indulge in the felicity of unbounded domesticity. We should quickly be personified, conjugally matrimonified by a doctor of divinity who is located in this vicinity.
We miss our opportunity of escaping with impunity. To the felicity of our maiden domesticity, we shall quickly be personified, conjugally matrimonified by a doctor of divinity who is located in this vicinity.
By a doctor of divinity who resides in this vicinity. By a doctor, doctor, doctor of divinity. Oh, divinity.
better pause, or danger may befall. Their father is a major general.
Yes, yes, he is a major general.
Yes, yes, I am a major general.
For he is a major general.
He is one of the major general.
It is a glorious thing to be a major general.
This is hurrah for the major general, hurrah for the major general.
Now then,
it's... General!
I understand equations with the simple and quadratical. About binomial theorem, I'm teeming with a lot of news. Lot of news, with many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse. I am very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings and animalculus. Jordan man is vegetable, animal, and mineral. I am the very model of a modern major general.
Jordan man is vegetable, animal, and mineral. He is the very model of a modern major general.
I know our mythic history, King Arthur's and Sir Caradox. I am Sir Harder Crossix, I have a pretty taste for paradox. I quote an elegiac of the crimes of Eulogabalus. Iconics I can flaw, peculiarities parabolous. I can tell undoubted Raphaels from Gerard Dalton's Orphanies. I know the croaking chorus from the frogs of Aristophanes. And I can have a fugue of which I've heard the music's dinner for. Dinner for? Oh dear. I'll never think of a rhyme for dinner for.
What? Never?
Well, hardly ever. And the whistle or the aspen then a fern or not is pinnacle.
The whistle or the aspen then a fern or not is pinnacle. The whistle or the aspen then a fern or not is pinnacle. The whistle or the aspen then a fern or not is pinnacle.
Then I can write a washing beard with a Babylonic uniform and tell you every detail of Caractacus's uniform. Jordan man is vegetable, animal, and mineral. I am the very model of a modern major general.
Jordan man is vegetable, animal, and mineral. He is the very model of a modern major general.
In fact, when I know what is meant by Mamelon and Ravelin, when I can tell at sight a mouse a rifle from a javelin, when such affairs as sorties and sobrieties, I'm more wary at, and when I know precisely what is meant by commissariat. Refreshing. When I have learned what progress has been made in modern gunnery, when I know more of tactics than a novice in a nunnery, in short, when I have a smattering of elemental strategy. Strategy. Oh dear. Let's see. I have it! You'll say a better major general has never sat at
you. You'll say a better major general has never sat at you. You say a better major general has never sat at you. You say a better major general has never sat at you.
For my military knowledge, though I'm plucky and inventory, has only been brought down to the beginning of the century. But still in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern major general.
But still in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, he is the very model of a modern major general.
Shall we? If fact, when I know what is meant by Babylon and Ravelin, when I can tell it's out of my tongue from a javelin, with such affairs as sorties and surprises, I'm aware yet, when I know precisely what is meant by commissariat. When I have learned what progress has been made in modern gunnery, when I know what in tactics than a novice in a nunnery, short when I'm a smattering of elemental strategy. Yes, strategy. You say a better major general has never rode a horse.
You say a better major general has never rode a horse. You say a better major general has never rode a horse. You say a better major general has never rode a horse.
For my military knowledge, though I'm plucky and adventuring, has only been rooted out of the beginning of the century, but still in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern major general.
But still in matters vegetable, animal, and mineral, he is the very model of a modern major general.
Introduced myself, I should like to have some idea of what is going on.
Oh, Papa, we...
Permit me. I'll explain in two words. We propose.
Oh, well, I never...
To marry your daughters.
Oh, dear me.
Against our wills, Papa! Against our wills!
Oh, but you mustn't do that.
Oh, no. May I ask, this is a rather picturesque uniform. But I am not familiar with it. What are you?
We are all single gentlemen.
Yes, I gathered that. Anything else?
No, nothing else.
Oh.
Papa, don't believe them. They are pirates.
Who dat?
Pirates of Penzance!
The legendary Pirates of Penzance!
I have often heard of them.
Oh, all except this gentleman, who was a pirate once, but who is out of his indentures today, and who means to lead a blameless life evermore.
But wait a bit! I object to pirates as sons-in-law.
We object to major generals as fathers-in-law. But we waive that point. We do not press it. We look over it.
An idea. And do you mean to say that you deliberately rob me of these, the sole remaining props of my old age, and leave me to go through the remainder of my life unfriended, unprotected, and alone?
Well, yes, that's the idea.
Tell me, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan?
Here we are again.
I ask you, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan?
Orphan?
Yes, orphan. Have you ever known what it is to be one?
I say, orphan.
Orphan, orphan, orphan!
I don't think we quite understand one another. I ask you, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan? And you say orphan. As I understand you, you are merely repeating the word orphan to show that you understand me.
I didn't repeat the word orphan.
Pardon me, you did indeed.
I only repeated it once.
True, but you repeated it.
But not orphan.
Stop, oh. I think I see where we are getting confused. When you said orphan, did you mean orphan, a person who has lost his parents? Or orphan, frequently.
Ah, I beg pardon. I see what you mean. Frequently.
You said orphan frequently.
No, only once.
Exactly. You said orphan frequently only once. Forgo your cruel employ. Have pity on my lonely state. I am an orphan boy.
An orphan boy.
An orphan.
I shall be indeed alone.
Poor fellow.
If pity you can feel, leave me my sorry remaining joy. See, at your feet they kneel, your heart you cannot steal against the sad, sad tale of the lonely. Orphan boy,
poor fellow.
See, at our feet they kneel, our hearts we cannot steal against the sad, sad tale of the lonely.
Over the billowy waters, if I hadn't an elegant diction, indulged in an innocent fiction, which is not in the same category as telling a regular terrible story.
If he's telling a terrible story, it's a terrible story. If he would have taken his sausages over the billowy waters, it is easy and elegant diction to call it an innocent fiction, when it comes in the same category as telling a regular terrible story. It's easy and elegant diction to call it an innocent fiction.
It's a useful thing to be an orphan boy.
It is a lovely orphan boy, a lovely orphan boy.
Oh, happy day with joyous king, we will away and marry thee.
Oh, happy day with joyous king, we will away and marry thee.
Should it be
called auspiciously, my sisters, all the bridesmaids be?
Should it be called auspiciously, my sisters, all the bridesmaids be? Oh, happy day with joyous king, we will away and marry thee. Should it be called
Yes, yes, remember Ruth, who kneels before you.
Away, you did deceive me.
Away, you did deceive him.
Oh, do not leave me.
Oh, do not leave her.
Away, you grieve me.
Away, you grieve him.
I wish you'd leave me.
We wish you'd leave him. The magnanimity we display to lay sendimity. Never was such opportunity to get married with impunity. Can we give up the felicity of unbounded domesticity? For a doctor of divinity is located in this vicinity.
Preserve the magnanimity they display to lay sendimity. Never was such opportunity to get married with impunity. Can we give up the felicity of unbounded domesticity? A doctor of divinity is located in this vicinity.
Will we give up the felicity of unbounded domesticity? Will we give up the felicity of unbounded domesticity?
This is
you in the calm excellence of your wisdom, reconcile it with your conscience to say something that will relieve my father's sorrow?
I will try, dear Mabel. But why does he sit night after night in this draughty old ruin?
Why do I sit here? Why do I sit here? Why do I sit here? To escape the pirate's clutches, I described myself as an orphan. And heaven help me, I am no orphan. I come here to humble myself before the tombs of my ancestors and to implore their pardon for having brought dishonor on the family escutcheon.
But you forget, sir, you only bought the property a year ago, and the stucco on your baronial castle is scarcely dry.
Frederick, in this chapel are ancestors. You cannot dispute that fact. With the estate, I bought the chapel and its contents. I don't know whose ancestors they were, but I know whose ancestors they are. And I shudder to think that their descendants by purchase, if I may so describe myself, should have brought disgrace upon what I have no doubt was an unstained escutcheon.
Bless you. Be comforted. Had you not acted as you did, these reckless men would assuredly have called in the nearest clergyman and married your large family on the spot.
I thank you for your proffered solace, but it is unavailing. I assure you, Frederick, that such is the anguish and remorse that I feel for the abominable falsehood by which I escaped these easily deluded pirates, that I would go to the simple-minded chief this very night and confess all. Did I not fear that the consequences would be most disastrous to myself? At what time does your expedition march against these scoundrels?
At 11. And before midnight, I hope to have atoned for my involuntary associations with the pestilent scourges by sweeping them from the face of the earth. And then, dear Mabel, you will be mine.
Are your devoted followers at hand?
They are. They only await my orders.
Then, Frederick, let your escort, lion-hearted, be summoned to receive a general's blessing ere they depart upon their dread adventure.
Dear sir, they come.
When the boring mares are still,
ta-ra-ta-ra, ta-ra-ta-ra,
comfortable fear,
ta-ra-ta-ra,
and we find the wisest thing,
ta-ra-ta-ra, ta-ra-ta-ra,
is to slap our chest and sing,
ta-ra-ta-ra. Tarantara, tarantara,
and your heart is in your abuse.
Tarantara,
there is nothing brings it round like the trumpet's martial sound, like the trumpet's martial sound.
Tarantara, 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 tarantara.
Glory, glory, glory.
of coming back. Still, perhaps it would be wise not to cop or criticize, for it's very evident these attentions are well meant.
Yes, it's very evident these intentions are well meant. Evident, yes, well meant. Evident, ah, yes, well meant.
Of duty stand dictation, I, circumstances victim, have been guilty.
Young Frederick,
who calls
your late commander,
and I, your little Ruth.
Oh, mad intruders, how dare ye face me? Know ye not, a rash one, that I have doomed you to extermination.
Have mercy on us. Hear us ere you slaughter.
I do not think I ought to listen to you. Yet mercy should lower our stern resentment. And so I will be merciful. Say on.
When you had left her pirate fold, we tried to raise our spirits faint, according to our custom old, with quips and quibbles quaint. But all in vain the quips we heard. We lay and sobbed upon the rocks until to somebody occurred a startling paradox.
A paradox.
A paradox, a most ingenious paradox. With quips and quibbles heard in flocks, but none to beat this paradox.
A paradox, a paradox, a most ingenious paradox. This paradox.
We knew your taste for curious quips, for cranks and contradictions queer, and with the laughter on our lips, we wished you there to hear. We said if we could tell it him, how Frederick would the joke enjoy. And so we've risked both life and limb to tell it to our boy.
That paradox.
That paradox, that most ingenious paradox. We've quips and quibbles heard in flux, but none to beat that paradox.
A paradox, a paradox, a most ingenious paradox.
This paradox.
which, however, I've no desire to be disloyal. Some person in authority.
Who?
I don't know who. Very likely the Astronomer Royal has decided that, although for such a beastly month as February, 28 days as a rule are plenty, 1 year in every 4 his days shall be reckoned as 29. Through some singular coincidence, I shouldn't be surprised if it were owing to the agency of an ill-natured fairy. Victim of this clumsy arrangement, having been born in leap year on the 29th of February. And so, by a simple arithmetical process, you'll easily discover that though you've lived 21 years, yet if we go by birthdays, you're only 5 and a little bit over.
Dear me, let's see. Yes, yes, with yours my figures do agree. Ha, 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 ha. How quaint the ways of paradox that common sense she gaily mocks. Though counting in the usual way, here's 21 I've been alive. Yet reckoning by my natal day, yet reckoning by my natal day. 4, 8, 12, 16. I am a little boy of 4.
It is a little boy of 4.
A paradox, a paradox, a most ingenious paradox.
Position. You were apprenticed to us.
Until I reached my 21st year.
No, until you reached your 21st birthday. And going by birthdays, you're as yet only 5 1/4.
You don't mean to say you're going to hold me to that?
No, we merely remind you of the fact and leave the rest to your sense of duty.
Your sense of duty?
Don't put it on that footing. Because I was merciful to you now, be merciful to me. I implore you not to insist on that letter of your bond, just as the cup of happiness is at my lips.
We insist on nothing. We content ourselves with pointing out to you your duty.
Your duty.
Well, you've appealed to my sense of duty, and my duty is only too clear. I abhor your infamous calling. I shudder at the thought of ever being mixed up with it. But duty is before all, and at any price, I will do my duty.
Bravely spoken. Come, you are one of us once more.
Lead on, I follow. Oh, horror!
What's the matter?
What did I tell you? No, no, I cannot do it. And yet it's one of your bands.
Speak out! I charge you by that sense of conscientiousness, to which we have never yet appealed in vain.
General Stanley.
Yes.
The father of my Mabel.
Yes.
He escaped from you on the plea that he was an orphan?
He did.
It breaks my heart to betray the honored father of the girl I adore. But as your apprentice, I have no alternative. It is my duty to tell you.
Yes.
That General Stanley.
Yes, yes.
Is no orphan.
What?
More than that, never was one.
Am I to understand that to save his contemptible life, he dared to practice on our credulous simplicity?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, our revenge shall be swift and terrible. We will go and collect our band and attack Tremorlin Castle this very night.
But stay.
Not a word. He is doomed.
Away, away, my heart's on fire. I burn this base deception to repay. This very night, my vengeance dire shall glut itself and gnaw away, away.
Away, away, ere I expire, I find my duty hard to do today. My heart is filled with anguish dire. It strikes me to the core, away, away.
With false fatal, he tricked us of our pride. That vengeance how the pirates so decide. On nature's turn, he softened with his lies. And in return, tonight the traitor dies.
Yes, tonight the traitor dies.
Yes, yes, tonight the traitor dies.
Tonight he dies.
Yes, and early tomorrow.
His girls likewise.
They will welter in sorrow.
The ones who smart.
In their natures they cherish.
And all the plots.
To abuse it shall perish. Tonight he dies. Yes, early tomorrow. His girls likewise. They will welter in sorrow.
The ones who smart. In their natures they cherish.
And all the plots. To abuse it shall perish. Away, away.
Away. Tonight the traitor dies.
Away, away. Tonight.
Thank you.
1640 IFH shall be. I'll then in turn and claim you, I declare it.
It seems so long.
Swear that till then you'll be true to me.
Yes, I'll be strong. By all the Stanleys dead and gone, I swear it.
Oh, here is love, and here is truth, and here is food for joy, our love, and you will be faithful to us soon. Oh, here is love, and here is truth.
Oh, here is love, and here is truth.
She will be faithful to her
soul. He will be faithful to her
soul. Till we are wed, and even after.
Till we are wed,
and even after.
Past even after.
Oh, here is love, and here is truth. And here is food for joy and laughter.
She will be faithful to her soul. Till we are wed, and even after.
She will be faithful to her soul. And even after, oh, here is love, and here is truth, oh, here is love, even love.
To regard him in that light. He has done his duty. I will do mine. Go ye and do yours.
Righto.
This is perplexing.
We cannot understand it at all.
Still, as he is actuated by a sense of duty.
That makes a difference, of course. At the same time, we repeat, we cannot understand it at all.
No matter. Our course is clear. We must do our best to capture these pirates alone.
It is most distressing to be the agents whereby our erring fellow creatures are deprived of that liberty which is so dear to us all. But we should have thought of that before we joined the force.
We should.
It's too late now.
It is.
Captain,
chance.
His capacity for innocent enjoyment.
Innocent enjoyment
is just as great as any honest man.
Honest man.
Our feelings we with difficulty smother.
Difficulty smother.
When constabulary duty is to be done.
To be done.
I take one consideration with another.
With another.
A policeman's law is not a happy one.
Oh, when constabulary duty's to be done, to be done. A policeman's law is not a happy one. Happy one.
When the enterprising burglar's not a burglar,
not a burglar.
When the cutthroat isn't occupied in crime,
I in crime.
He loves to hear the little brook a gurgling,
brook a gurgling,
and listen to the many village chime,
village chime.
I do believe I said chime, laddie. Thank you. When the coster's fin is jumping on his mother,
on his mother,
he loves to lie basking in the sun,
in the sun.
I'll take one consideration with another,
with another.
A policeman's law is not a happy one.
When constabulary duties to be done, to be done. A policeman's law is not a happy one. Happy one.
Hush, hush, I hear them on the manor approaching. With stealthy steps, the pirates are approaching.
We are not coming for fame, but for the story. So, we seek a penalty, 54, a generous
standing story. We seek a penalty,
54, we seek a penalty,
54, we seek a penalty, 54, for General Stanley's story.
They come in force with stealthy stride. Our obvious course is now to hide!
Your silent matches.
sentences. Take your file and your skeletonic piece.
With cat-like tread, in silent tread. With cat-like tread upon a prairie steel, in silent tread, a cautious way we feel. No sound at all, we never speak a word. A fly's foot forward be distinctly heard. Come, friends, who plow the sea, choose to navigation, take another station. Let's bury piracy with a little mercury, with cat-like tread upon a gray we steal. His eyes tread a cautious way we feel.
The general comes, so quickly hide.
Yes, yes, the major general comes.
Yes, yes, the major general comes.
Yes, yes, the major general comes. Tormented with the anguish dread of falsehood unatoned, I lay upon my sleepless bed and tossed and turned and groaned. The man who finds his conscience ache, no peace at all enjoys. And as I lay in bed awake, I thought I heard a noise.
He thought he heard a noise.
On him, my mind is set at ease. So still the sea, it must have been. The sighing of the breeze. Softly to the river comes the loving breeze, setting nature all a quiver, rustling through the trees.
Through the trees.
And the brook in rippling measure laughs for very love, while the poplars in their pleasure wave their arms above.
Yes, the trees for very love.
breezes but a rover when he wings away. Brook and poplar mourn a lover sighing when the day.
When the day.
Of a doing and undoing that the rogue could tell. When the breeze is out a wooing, who can woo so well?
Advantage you've contrived, but your proud triumph will not be long lived.
Don't say you're orphans, for we know that game.
On your allegiance, we've a stronger claim. We charge you yield. We charge you yield in Queen Victoria's name.
We charge you yield in Queen Victoria's name.
King. Pears will be pears, and youth must have its fling. Resume your ranks and legislative duties, and take my daughters, most of whom are beauties.
At length we are provided with unusual facility to trade piratic crime for dignified respectability.
Combined, I needn't say, with the unparalleled felicity of what we have been longing for, unbounded domesticity.
Tomorrow morning early, we will quickly be personified.
By many only coupled, conjugally matrimonified.
And this shall be accomplished by the Doctor of Divinity. Who happily resides in the immediate vicinity.
For my military knowledge, though I'm plucky and adventury, has only been brought down to the beginning of the century. But still, in marrying off my daughters, 8 or 9 or 10 in all, I've shown myself the model of a modern major general.
But still, in marrying off his daughters, 8 or 9 or 10 in all, he's shown himself the model of a modern major general.